Artbound. In this episode, Artbound celebrates Black History Month with a special episode featuring the works of African American artists in Southern California, including the assemblage sculptures of Noah Purifoy.
Because his work uses junk, people assume that that's an outsider. There is this kind of unmade formalism to it.
William Pope.L's large-scale installation, Trinket.
We use flags to prop up certain desires or lacks that we have. Perhaps that is why the flag can be so contentious.
Candacy Taylor's photographic exploration of beauty shop culture.
This was a representation of the American story, and this is what they were lacking in their archives.
The African American photographer collection at Cal State Northridge.
I love LA history. You know, it's fascinating history. It's not given the credit it's due as far as African Americans are concerned, you know, and civil rights and everything.
And a behind-the-scenes look at Aloe Blacc's cover of the song When the Girl You Love Lives in California. On the next Artbound.
My name is Tanya Mladen. I am an arts and culture writer based in Los Angeles. When Noah Purifoy was in his 70s, he didn't have enough money to stay in Los Angeles and live. So he moved out to the desert, right outside of Joshua Tree, and he created the Noah Purifoy Outdoor Desert Art Museum of Assemblage Sculpture. Museum is kind of not the right word for it. It's more like a theme park for adults to go see art. But it was where he spent his retirement and was still able to make art. Even in the last 5 years of his life, he was wheelchair bound. He was having his friends help him construct these beautiful sculptures, like one called Ode to Frank Gehry, which looks like it's sheet metal and it's white, but you can see the kind of formal elements that influenced the piece. And then he had some very politically charged pieces. He had one called Voting Booth, and inside the voting booth, there was a toilet. When he moved to the desert, I think that's when he did his most interesting work, because that was when he was the most free. And as a consequence, his work in the desert is huge. There are huge sculptures that he couldn't have done in the city. And he probably wouldn't have had the inspiration. To him, the elements were very much an inspiration, and the way that things naturally decayed and created new things. For him, that became part of the work and informed part of the work.
Noah was really interested in the creative process. And that's something he talked about endlessly. There was a lot of talk that he was an outsider artist, but in fact he wasn't. He studied art at Chouinard, which later became Cal Arts. Because his work uses junk, people assume that that's an outsider, you know, because it isn't, doesn't have this kind of formal quality. There's a very formal quality to it, but there is this kind of unmade formalism to it.
There's so many textures going on and so many types of forms that it doesn't look like iconic land art statements. Though there are these major interests that so many of these artists, including Noah Purifoy, share, and those are how is nature affecting the process? How is erosion and light and shadow and heat affecting what you're doing in the land? But I do think it's interesting to note the differences, because there was this talk in the 60s with land artists of leaving this white cube system, and that was joined by a reality that many of these artists had financial support and were also exhibiting at galleries that were internationally known and respected. And that is a very different reality from Noah's reality.
My parents were sharecroppers. And by the time I was three, I was out in the field trying to help them pick cotton.
Noah was born in 1917. I'm not sure if people can imagine what that world was like for a black person. But it was, I'm sure it was challenging. And the odyssey of his life takes place like he's born in that situation, not in a wealthy family, and then goes on to go to college. And what he wanted to do is be a teacher. He studied history, but at that time they'd only let him teach shop. So right out of the gate, he's met with the confrontation of the American dream versus his reality and his view of the world.
After the war, he did degrees in social work and then made his way out to California.
Purifoy came here as a migrant, part of a huge swath of people trying to get away from the American Southeast and its history. So when I think about that space, I think about a greater sense of African retention because of its proximity. And so you don't have the same thing out here. It just doesn't exist.
He arrived in LA in 1951 and first was working as a social worker at a county hospital.
And he's working there for a while, and one day he just gets up and walks out because he knows that this isn't going to do anything either.
Then in 1964, he was offered the opportunity to step on as the founding director of the Watts Towers Art Center. And that was a really big turning point for him as an artist.
Not making objects, but bringing different kinds of people together really became his artwork.
So the Watts Towers Art Center's mission, in addition to working with the community, was to use found objects, because Simon Rodia had used found objects in this masterpiece of his. And then shortly after he stepped on there, there was this massive race rebellion in Watts. It became one of the most violent events of the 60s. There were numerous race rebellions at that moment in time, and of course we're living in a moment in time where this continues. So in the wake of August 1965, he went out into the streets of Watts, which really resembled Dresden. You know, it was completely bombed out, charred everything, and began collecting this burnt debris.
And I think at that point, when you're so actively involved in collecting that material, even whether it's from a riot or whether it's out here in the desert, you begin to have a different view of who you are and how you fit into the picture of the world. And that was Noah's way of responding to that.
That moment, Watts essentially, was really the catalyst for Noah as an artist. He decided that using found objects would be a sort of manifesto. And he and his colleague Judson Powell gathered together a group of six other artists and did this landmark undertaking, which they called 66 Signs of Neon, not only as a way to explore assemblage, but to also use these statements as a tool to talk about societal issues affecting not just Los Angeles, but the nation.
There are all these reference points in Purifoy's work to Dadaism, to Surrealism. those artists who were working in the wake of World War I and working from an environment that could only be identified as having been destroyed. And I think Purifoy definitely comes from that place, amongst others. And then to think about how art is not just something to be looked at, which is also the other thrust of Purifoy's career, which forces the question of how can one be most effective?
I think that's really the basis of his activism, not necessarily going out and manning the barricades in the community, but trying to present things that might not be there so people could see outside of where they were.
Then in 1972, he left the art world. He was completely disenchanted by the early 70s with how little change had actually happened and how impoverished and still broken down life was in Watts. And he was offered the position as one of the founding members of the California Arts Council, which Governor Jerry Brown started in 1976.
And he's works with the Arts Council for about 10 years. And there's some kind of discussion about him not making art for 10 years, but I feel that it's at that point that his real conceptualism comes out, because he begins to develop programs, artists in schools, artists in communities, artists in prisons. And his work leaves the kind of the physical thing and becomes much more conceptual.
Many artists in the 60s took up social issues, but to feel convicted enough to devote every day of your life to trying to enact change.
He had this incredibly rich life that had different modes at different times. So there is that push-pull between the art and the activism. And I think that he brought those things together at different times in his life.
In 1987, though, he's getting older, and he decided he wanted to basically retire and to return to his studio practice, but wasn't able to make ends meet. He was living on Social Security, did not have the money to live in LA, did not have gallery representation, did not have someone bankrolling anything he was doing. And, you know, these are the realities of an artist who is trying to live, make work, and isn't supported by a major blue chip gallery, doesn't have financial backing, and he couldn't do it.
So he moves out here and then begins to develop these pieces. And that's how we get here. Noah believed that the desert was a partner with him in the creative process and whatever he was doing. I don't believe Noah was particularly interested in you knowing what he was thinking about. It was what your experience was with his work and how that made you, or what that made you think about, and how it made you look at yourself. That is what I believe he was into.
His practice changed when he moved to Joshua Tree. You know, in LA, trash was so plentiful. There was junk just piled, especially on the streets of Watts. And here, people recycle everything. And so he found himself for the first time going to swap meets and trying to strike up relationships with local businesses and neighbors, telling everyone, look, you know, I use everything. So if you have extra materials, bring them to me. And this is what he created. So all of these pieces, you know, speak to these experiences in oblique ways. You know, you look at them and they're aesthetic statements, and they're speaking about all these sorts of formal problems, but then there's these stories that lurk behind them. This piece that we're sitting in is called Shelter, and it relates to his experiences as a social worker and reflected on the experience of living in LA in the 80s during the Reagan administration, when so many people were kicked out of mental institutions and ended up on the streets of LA. He spoke about this piece as being a shelter for the homeless, a shelter for everyone.
You know, the idea is that we take these things and they all have a meaning to them, and once we place them in a different environment, the meaning changes. And that's where his interest lied. Well, why does that happen? And how do we put those things together? And that's what the creative process to him was. It was solution. The creative process becomes a solution methodology.
Philosophy was something that really fueled him as an artist and as a person from the 50s through to his time out in Joshua Tree. And he never stopped talking about how fascinated he was by thinkers like Husserl and Heidegger and trying to explore phenomenology as a process and this idea of oneness with the world, something that he felt he was more in tune with when creating work, especially out here in the desert alone. Something that I like to point out to people when they're out here is that he was 72 when he moved out to the desert, and he had no assistants. And these days in the art world, I mean, every studio is full of a gazillion assistants. Nobody can make their own work because that's not what the machine demands. But he was out here doing this all by himself until 1999, when he had to use a wheelchair. And over the last 15 years of his life, he built this masterpiece.
Coming out here to the desert was perfect for him because it allowed him the freedom to work without the framework and consciousness of a commercial space. And ironically, you know, LACMA wasn't going to show his work back in the day. So, you know, he came out and made his own museum. That was his response to, oh, you want to show my stuff? Okay. I think it's important to realize that, let's say like at the end of the Civil War, that ended 250 years of it being illegal to teach a black person how to read and write. And in a certain sense, we're not that much further away from that today. So why is Noah's work important? It's important because he really was the touchstone for a lot of other artists to feel safe enough to make their expression outside of what was thought of as being art. It's also important that institutions recognize people of color who are artists and to really kind of insert them into the history because they're not there.
So the fact that it wasn't all coming from galleries around the world, because he did not have that reception when he was living, it surprises some people. And I think that that surprise is partially why there has been, I think, a pretty great reception for the exhibition, is because people, a lot of people did not know the work.
You know, the Whitney just opened. And there's, if I'm not mistaken, about a third of the artists in the Whitney are artists of color. Now, 10 years ago, that wouldn't have happened. But it's about the recognition that it's all relevant and it's all important. That has not been the tone of our society, ever. Thank you.
My name is Bennett Simpson. I'm senior curator at MoCA. I've been here for 8 years now. MoCA, I think, has from the beginning been a kind of risk-taking place. Maybe it has not always had the polish or package of other museums, but we have consistently kind of done things with artists that are very unique, experimental, challenging, first time for a lot of things. I was in Chicago at a panel discussion. You know, I was on a panel at the University of Chicago, and Pope.L came up to me afterwards and said, "Hey, I have a project that I think would be great at the Geffen." At that time, we were really in transition. We didn't have a director. There was a lot kind of on hold in some sense. But I said, "Let's talk again in a few months." I knew things were going to clear up and clear out, then Pope.L proposed this work called Trinket. Trinket consists of an American flag, a custom-made American flag, 54 feet long, 16 feet high, that hangs on a pole in the middle of the Geffen. And it is being blown by four really big special effects fans. You know, if you need a big wind, you use these fans. The fan blades are 7 feet in diameter. They're huge machines. We see flags all the time. Flags are commonplace, no big deal. Big flags, we see them all the time. But you don't see one indoors, and you don't see one up close. You can stand 5 feet away from this flag. The flag feels alive. It's kind of rippling and snapping in the space of the museum. And there's a lot of wind, and it's blowing you too. If you stand in certain places in the wind, you can affect the way the wind blows, and you can affect the way the flag flies. The ends will become tattered and frayed. Pope.L, the artist, has helped them along that path by kind of loosening the seams, so they're already kind of like tentacles at the ends. Over time, the flag will change. Just like over time, America changes, concept of democracy changes, who we are in relation to nationhood changes. People have asked, you know, what's the 51st star for? Why are there 50? There are only 50 stars on the flag. Why did he add a star? There are a lot of ways you can answer that. They're all interesting. Potential for change, potential for more. There's always a potential for more in America, you know? There's always, like, a little something extra for you. So the metaphorical potential is rich. This is not a show that would happen at LACMA. This is not a show that would happen at the Getty or the Hammer. I think you find things at MoCA that you don't find at other places. And Pope.L show was one of them. You know, he's an artist I'd always wanted to work with. And I was thrilled when Philippe arrived. He kind of got behind the project. He's really one of the artists who pushes the kind of envelope of what, you know, what performance art is, what installation art is. He asks big questions in his work that have lots of different answers, depending on who you are and where you come from. The work is both utterly mysterious and very familiar and accessible.
I like this sort of, I like that objects in our culture, and maybe because we have so many of them, they start to take on qualities that maybe they don't possess. And the flag has this similar kind of, how would you say, animism about it, right? We bestow it this inner life. So I'm trying to take that seriously. This particular flag, this one out here, that one, I made it. We added one star, so that's my flag. It's not yours, it's mine. Only kidding, we share in the largesse, don't we? Yes, we do. Trinket is the largest work in this exhibition called Trinket. The show has been built in a way with sort of Trinket as a kind of flexible center, oscillating, if you will. The hinge between Trinket and the other works in the exhibition is duration. An active enduring is something that talks about an ongoingness, but an ongoingness that has it's under stress. Like the flag is falling apart. Over time, the flag will simply open up like a flower. That in itself suggests a kind of aliveness. So I think the flag for me is sort of the, it's a space. It's a space of disagreement and agreement. And that's what makes it a very interesting space. You have to honor it in a way that you wouldn't if it was a lapel pin. And you respect its power, which is what we're supposed to do with a flag, I suppose. But I think a number of Americans have been questioning this their relationship, their coziness to this emblem. You know, a nation that decides that it is larger than justice, or a nation that decides that it is larger than knowledge, or a nation that decides that it's larger than its citizenry. You know, it's sort of like that mouse that believes because it can blot out the moon with its paw, that it is mightier than the moon. And I think that nations make that error. And so in certain ways, you know, flags are, how would you say, they're prostheses. We use flags to prop up certain desires or lacks that we have. Perhaps that is why the flag can be so contentious. Many people have diverging opinions and attitudes about and causes them to come to fisticuffs. What word would best suit this? And I thought, well, why not a word that has very little space in it? When speaking of big things, use small words. Trinket. It has more letters, perhaps, than I would like.
My name is Ted Quinn, and I'm a musician and a writer and cultural activist in Joshua Tree, California, where I am also a contributor to Artbound. I wrote a story about Candacy Taylor because I thought she was a fascinating person. She's a cultural anthropologist who is interested in working class people and multiple ethnicities. One thing that really struck me about Candacy's work in the beauty salons was seeing the beauty salon as a social network, where today we have the internet and we have the Facebook and we have all of this social interaction through the internet. But the beauty shop is really the original social network, where people came together to tell stories, to spread rumors, to catch up on gossip. It's very much like what we do online.
I am with Bernice and Earl Adams, and we are in Los Angeles in the original Max Factor house. Earl, can you tell me a little bit, just in the beginning, how you started doing hair?
Well, my folks were the ones that decided I was going to be a hairdresser. I was not artistic in school. They had friends that were hairdressers that I'd never met, and they ate during the Depression. And my mother and dad decided I was going to be a hairdresser. Didn't say to me, is this what you would like to do? You're going to go. There were three men in the class of 130 women. I didn't know the difference between a hairpin and a bobby pin.
I make multimedia projects that challenge different stereotypes. I look at different subcultures throughout the country, dealing with projects that have labor, class, gender involved. I studied fine art, but my work, especially my photography work, is more documentary in style. I'm starting a new project documenting beauty shop culture in America. I just was awarded a grant from the Library of Congress. It's an amazing honor. And when I found the grant, I thought, this is made for me. It was about capturing stories of American workers, archiving their stories. And the fact that I was featuring mostly women, especially people of color, different cultures, this was a representation of the American story, and this is what they were lacking in their archives.
I remember the first time I went into work as a hairstylist, my boss said, I just have to kind of throw you in. You know, you learn by doing, and if you're not going through these experiences, you won't be a better hairstylist. I love what I do. I love working with all different types of hair textures. My husband's black, my daughter's half black and Filipino. So growing up with different types of hair textures, Filipinos have like straight to wavy to curly hair naturally. So I'm always around that. My niece is half Spanish, half Filipino, but she always wanted to wear her hair straight because her hair was massively curly. But as she got into her junior high school years, she learned how to work with her natural curly hair. And I was so proud of her because, you know, that's a part of her. That's who she is.
I remember being raised in Houston, Texas with a mother who was using a hot comb on my hair. I was pretty traumatized. This was a 300 plus degree hot comb sizzling my hair to straighten it. And if you weren't sitting through getting your hair pressed by a hot comb, you were trying to get your naps combed with a real comb. And I thought, I don't know if my white friends really have to go through this. I started this project on hair, the Beauty Shop Culture Project, about 7 years ago, mostly because I lived in San Francisco for almost 20 years, and I went to the same hairdresser year after year after year called Gigi Matthews Salon, and it was all black. I never saw anybody of any other race, and I just thought it was very interesting. And a white woman came in to the salon one day. She said, I just want to have a, you know, wash and set, which is a very simple thing. And Gigi turned her away. And as soon as she left, she said, I don't do white hair. And I thought that was incredible because Gigi's not a racist, but she was almost protecting this environment. She was protecting the culture and the conversations that were happening in that space. And I was there because they knew how to deal with my hair texture. I thought, I wonder if other salons are like this. What about Latino salons, Japanese salons? What about salons that just focus on a particular culture? So it all comes back down to hair texture, which intrinsically is tied to race.
I met Michael Jackson in 1998 at the first hair salon I worked at in Los Angeles. He was a friend of the receptionist that worked there. And so she called me up and she said, Michael Jackson wants to know if you can do black hair. And I said, well, yeah, I can. Because in fact, I was trained on black hair. A majority of the clients who came into the beauty school that I went to in Ohio were African American. And so I was comfortable saying, yes, I can, and I will do it well. So Katia has naturally curly hair that is tighter in some areas, looser in some areas. So we wanted to create a consistent curl that we will kind of pull back into a loose, low chignon.
In the olden days when women would get their hair done, it was, I think it took a lot of time, and it was time to gossip and talk and visit, right?
Yeah.
And so you have that feel here.
We have it.
So my girlfriend and I, we schedule our appointments together. We come here and we visit with Jeff, who's also what I consider a close friend of mine now. We've been out together and cried together and laughed together. So that's what it is for me.
The Beauty Shop Project was a really great entryway for me to deal with race and to deal with ethnicity in a new way. And I just want to be careful how I represent other types of people. So it's a risk. That's why people don't like to talk about race, because they're afraid they're going to say the wrong thing or they're going to do the wrong thing. And I think we need to open up and broaden the discussion and allow people to say things that they're afraid to say so that we can really get to the truth.
We're going to spend a little time with Kent Crichton and Keith Rice at the Tom and Ethel Bradley Center at Cal State Northridge. Kent Crichton started a collection without, as so often happens, quite meaning to, of African-American photography in Southern California. African-American photography in Southern California, especially journalistic photography, gives a different angle on the known history or the history we think we know. Los Angeles Times has never been completely oblivious to African-American history. At times, they've even been rather attentive to it, but attentive to it at specific times. If there's a shooting in South Central Los Angeles, the Los Angeles Times is right on the scene with photographs of, you know, the aftermath of a god-awful event. Well, the Los Angeles Sentinel, the California Eagle, these were African-American papers based in these neighborhoods. And so they're not just covering crime, although they didn't ignore it. They're covering birthday parties and political rallies and the most natural, mundane aspects of African-American lives as they were lived in Southern California, which the LA Times, God love it, was fairly oblivious to. You see Los Angeles treated as a small town, because in effect these were small town newspapers. They were smaller in some cases than they wanted to be because restrictive covenants kept them from getting any bigger. So it is a fascinating sort of documentary history of a Los Angeles that you would never see reading more mainstream papers.
You know, we talk about the important historical events that newspaper photographers covered, and it's important for the people of the city to be able to recover their own history, and there really isn't much of a place to do this. When you bring this stuff together in a collection, in an archive, then you can begin to see what great work they've done, what great documentation for the community they've done, and how important it is. We're primarily an archives with a focus on the ethnic communities in the Los Angeles region. The collection came to be, it's one of those long serendipitous stories, but as a faculty member, I was interested in the alternative press. And I was interested in whether the alternative press was using photography differently than the mainstream press. And I was working on writing an academic paper. And I was looking for some images from Black LA to go with the paper, and I couldn't find any. And I didn't know all of the archives in town, and I didn't know all the libraries and stuff, but nonetheless, what I was searching, I couldn't find anything, and I thought, it's amazing to the extent to which the ethnic communities in this city are undocumented in the institutional holdings. The mainstream newspapers hold their own archives in the morgue, right? They've got it all. So there was no sense in trying to get into that area of collecting because they're not going to let go of that. But the photographers working on alternative newspapers were all freelancers, and they owned all their own stuff. So once I figured that out, met the first couple of Black photographers that I met, things really began to take off then. We now hold over 1 million photographic images. About 850,000 of them are produced by African-American photographers. Most of the Black photographers whose work we have collected were not schooled. They didn't really think of themselves as photographers in the way contemporary photographers do. And so, for instance, Harry Adams, who was a barber, started making photographs, and somebody said, hey, can I have some copies of those, this, that, and the other thing? And he started practicing a little bit and selling a few photographs. And his barbershop was next door to the Los Angeles Sentinel. And Los Angeles Sentinel was one of two major papers in the Black community at the time, the other being the California Eagle. And Harry went to work for them, as best we can tell. His earliest photographs are around 1958. Harry was shooting 4x5s with a speed graphic, right? A sheet of film was expensive. He got paid for the print, by the print that he turned into the newspaper. And it didn't occur to him to come back and, let's go down Central Avenue and make some shots just for the fun of it, just because I like it, you know. He didn't have a roll of film in his camera. He had one or two sheets. He went out and shot the job, came back, turned it in, got paid. It was his job. And he approached it like any working guy would approach his job. And he put down his camera at the end of the day and said, phew, I'm going home.
I love L.A. history. You know, it's fascinating history. It's not credited or given the credit it's due as far as African Americans are concerned, you know, and civil rights and everything, and I find that really interesting. We always look at that as a Southern thing. You know, people came to L.A., there was no discrimination in L.A. L.A., everybody was happy and everybody got along. I just did an oral history with an interview with Mrs. Nola Carter, who is the mother of Apprentice Bunchy Carter, who started a Black Panther Party here in Los Angeles and was killed at UCLA. She's 96 years old, and she was telling me, when she left Shreveport, Louisiana, she knew what discrimination was, even though she really didn't encounter a lot of discrimination. She went to an all-black school, she shopped in white stores, black stores, but you knew, when you got on the streetcars, it said white, it said black. What she told me is when she got to LA, there were no signs. But when you got on a bus or a trolley and you sat in a car or in a seat, a white person would get up and stand and hold on. And that's how discrimination was played out here. So I say that to say that, you know, LA wasn't what people thought it was totally. And people also didn't recognize that actors and everybody, they helped support the civil rights movement. There's a lot of money in Los Angeles. So they would come, Dr. King seemed like he, from these photographs, it seemed like he was here every other month, raising money to support while he was, his work in the South.
In 1963, Dr. King came to speak in Los Angeles. He was here for the weekend. And, you know, Raphael Bernathy was there and Sammy Davis Jr. and, you know, a whole list of Hollywood notables that were supportive of the civil rights movement. And the story that I've heard many times is they collected so much money for the SCLC that day that they took big plastic garbage cans up into the stands and filled them with folding money, which they then carried down and had to take off and count all the ones and fives and what, but they had garbage cans full of money that they collected for him that day. And it was a high point in the community as part of the civil rights movement. And we have photographs from more than one of the photographers that covered that event. And you can see that it's a celebratory event. The Los Angeles Times was there. And at one point, some guy wanted to say something or what, I don't know. Anyhow, he tried to take the microphone, tried to go up on the stand and take the get control of the microphone. And a couple of policemen grabbed him and took him away. That was the photograph that the Los Angeles Times used, right? As if some kind of violence had occurred at this event. The work of these photographers differs from mainstream photographers in a couple of ways. First is in the subjects they select. And secondly is in their sense of who they're photographing, and their membership in the community leads them to have a different perspective on the people they're photographing than the big metropolitan paper that drops into the neighborhood occasionally, usually to cover some crime or some other circumstances. We participated in the Pacific Standard Time project that the Getty organized. And the title of our show was Identity and Affirmation. We chose that to reflect what was going on in the black community during this post-war period. This was a time when the black community was a bit more affluent. It was a little stratified. Certainly at the top end, they were affluent. And the photographs reflect that at the time, there were a lot of activities that were meant to demonstrate they deserved full citizenship in the country, that they were doing things equally as the mainstream was doing, and they were reaffirming. They were affirming their own progress and status.
This work is rewarding to me because I don't think African Americans, I don't think we even value this information. I don't think we value history as much as we should. But because a lot of young people have no idea of why they can do the things they can do. Knowing that anything that black people do now is because somebody before them did the work.
The Institute for Arts and Media here at California State University has recently partnered with the Tom and Ethel Bradley Foundation. And we have created the Tom and Ethel Bradley Center here on campus. Because of our mutual interest, we are broadening our collecting policy. So we really want to expand our areas now into a broader effort to tell the stories of the ethnic communities in Los Angeles. So our goal here is to make this a major national research center where we'll have scholars coming from wherever. If they're interested in Los Angeles or various ethnic communities in Los Angeles, they'll know, it'll soon be clear that this is a place for them to do their research.
Aloe Blacc, a contemporary hip hop and R&B artist. And I wanted him to really, you know, a big part of the collection is the relationship between the history of African American music and the history in the long history of Los Angeles. And so he chose a song not written by African American songwriters from 1917, and actually did two versions of it. Did a very literal version and then reinterpreted it as a kind of a blues. It was a perfect example of that transformation that we were hoping to hear.
Got a wire from a friend of mine out there. Told me of his marriage to this girl so fair. They had met up on the train. Now I don't know just who to blame.
All right, headphones.
Took a California girl to win my heart. Bought the ring and everything and had to part. Kissed her goodbye at the train. Never heard from her again. Got a wire from a friend of mine out there. Told me of his marriage to this girl so fair. They had met up on the train. Now I don't know just who to blame.
Coming from hip-hop music, you know, you just make it up all on your own, other than bars you're sampling from people who largely probably didn't work with sheet music, you know, were probably self-taught musicians and recorded amazing songs and then, you know, makes it into my record collection and I sample it, write lyrics on top. And as a songwriter, I never work with sheet music. I never transcribe anything. It's not my world at all. My world is to think it and then play it. And if someone else wants to play it, they're gonna have to figure it out.
Got a wire from a friend of mine out there. Told me of his marriage to this girl so fair. They had met up on the train. Now I don't know just who. When the girl.
Tyler.
Yes, sir.
At the top of the chorus, I want to punch in. When the girl you love lives in California.
Punch in or double?
Punch.
Punch, all right.
Working off sheet music definitely changes the way I approach the creative process because I want to hear the voice of the writers. I want to know what they intended. And sheet music tells you, it gives you all of the rhythms, the key, all the direction you need to recreate what they intended. And then once you've done that, you can kind of get an idea of some of the nuances that they may not have put in the writing. Once you learn it in the voice that it's written in, sky's the limit. And you can interpret it in your own voice and interpret it in almost any era, any genre. I definitely feel like the landscape changes it. I mean, you know, beach culture and the mixture of rock or punk and ska in the stuff that came out of like Huntington Beach and some of the bands that come from the coast. You can definitely tell that's not something that would really happen anywhere else. As a lyricist, reading the lyrics and thinking about how it's put together, you can tell linguistically that it was a different time, and you can tell that the wording and the way that things are described completely different from how they would be described today. I don't know, you just get a sense of this other time where, but the emotions are all still the same. When the girl you love lives in California, and you're living down in New York, it's a long way to go when you want a kiss, and you can't keep your eye on your love and miss. There's lots of boys out there in California who'd like to find her too, and she's out to forget that we ever met when she. Yeah, it's a love song, a song about longing, a little bit of desperation, a little bit of self-doubt, you know. Quite interesting, quite an interesting story, and I thought it was probably the easiest to interpret in an alternate way, like in a blues way, because it sounds like, lyrically, it sounds like a blues song. When the girl you love lives in California, and you're living way down in New York, it's a long way to go when you want a kiss, and you can't keep your eye on your loving miss. There's a lot of boys out there in California, they want to find her too, and she's apt to forget that you ever met when she gets away from you, and she's apt to forget that you ever met once she gets away from you, and she's apt to forget that you ever met once she gets away from you.
California girl to win my heart, I bought the ring and everything that had to part, kissed her goodbye at the train, never heard from her again, got a wire from a friend of mine out there, told me of his marriage to this girl so fair. And she's apt to forget that we ever met when she once gets away.